Hello, and welcome back for another live show from our cartoon studio with us, the Luck Creative brothers, Scott and Anthony Evans. Ant, how's everything going this week?
All good.
Really? All good?
Yeah, all good. Wow. Not all good.
Okay. Well, this week we have yet another fantastic guest to advise all of you animators out there with some vital information if you wish to grow your online presence and build your animation brands. Joining us later in the cartoon studio tonight is Mr. Nate Olson, who is the Director of Marketing, Licensing and Publicity for Frederator Network. We have plenty of questions for Mr. Olson to help you all grow your own channels. So have your notepads ready, and remember, if you have any questions, please do post them in the live chat and we will put as many of them forward as possible at the end of the interview. Now, normally, we do the interviews first, but I think there's been a bit of a mix-up because obviously Mr. Olson is joining us from New York in the USA. It's 9 o'clock here in the UK and I thought it was 5 o'clock in New York. I think it is actually 4 o'clock. Is that right, Ant?
Yeah, I think so. Oh, so this is your fault then?
Possibly. I'll have to check back over the emails. There's been a mix-up somewhere. So hopefully we will get Mr. Nate Olson on the show to join us a little bit later on. So we're going to do it back to front today. We're going to do school time first. Then we're going to do cartoon news. And hopefully at some point we'll do the interview as well. So, Anthony, what are you teaching us in school today?
Well, today I'm going to do a quick run through on how to do an animated turn for a walk cycle with a character. Because at the moment, if you have a walk cycle setup, if you press left or right, all it does is jumps to that left or right profile. And I'm going to show how to add a smooth transition in between just to make it look a little bit better. So, should we go to school time?
Yep, school time.
Started.
Yep.
Here we are, school time. I need board. We need music for this. Da-da-da-da, school time. Okay. Okay, in today's school time, we're going to talk about how to add a transition between for a turn for the walk cycles. So if you wanted to set your character to walk, as it's set up, it'll just flip to whichever profile, left or right profile. But if you put in a cycle layer, you can actually add in a smooth turn, and then the walk cycle works. So I will quickly show you how we do this. I mean, this is a 3D character, so the turn is created within the 3D software. As you can see here, we would render out the frames going from front view to side view. So I've gone for 9 frames. It may be a little bit too many because it's a bit slow, so it probably want to be less, but for this purpose it shall do the job. As you can see here within the Photoshop file, right profile is just set up. We've got our heads, arms, legs, torso, and all that set up for a normal walk cycle. But for the left side, I've put everything that that's ready for the left profile into another folder. And then I've got the walk cycle frames running down before that. So they've got to be in order from 1 to however many it is. And then the last layer has to be a folder containing all your walk cycle elements. So that's set up there. Then once you've brought that in and go back into Character Animator, you can see in the rig all the setup. So again, you've got your walk cycles. I've got a cycle layer added to this, so it's from top to bottom, forward and reverse on, and hold on last layer. So basically what's going to happen is it's going to run through this cycle, then this is the last layer it's going to hold on, and this layer's got the information for your walk cycle, which is all set up already. So When that's done, you go to your character, and you can see when you turn, it runs the animation, and then runs the walk cycle, other than a quick skip. And then, if we wanted to do the other side, we would just go ahead then and re-render out the character to be turned to that side. And we render those frames out and then bring them in the same way. We'd have to put these into a folder, put them into setup, and then if you had those frames, we would bring them up into there and save the file. But bear in mind, if you, by bringing them all into a new folder, you will have to go in and reset up all your handles and bones. But it's just a nice little way to give you a bit more of a smooth animation for walk cycles. If there's any questions, just feel free to leave a comment and we will try and answer the best we can. Thank you very much. And that was school time. Yeah, like I say, just a simple way of just, it kind of just fills in the gap. It makes it a lot more smooth. It's a nice little tip.
It's a simple tutorial, but it's an important one because obviously, as I've said in many of the previous shows, ultimately, I think the way that character animator is going is that you could make, you can use it to make a full cartoon animation. It's not just for doing live avatars. And you could do like a proper, like in the olden days with soap operas, you could have all the cartoon characters and you can have them all live. And doing a turn in the walk cycle just, you know, keeps the consistency because it is a bit jolting when the character just cuts left and right. So it's definitely a very nice feature that everyone should incorporate into their character design. Yeah? You got anything to say to that, Anthony?
I have not. I'm going to leave you to... I've just got to sort something out technical side-wise, so I'm going to put my busy working thing up and
you're going to give us a heads up what that technical problem might be?
No, you're all right. You keep going.
Oh, well, that's all dandy. But since... Okay, just so I can explain something to people, in case you don't know, this live show is actually operated from two premises. So I'm in one office on one side of town. Anthony's in the other office at the other side of town. And it's from his office that he actually controls, he does all the engineering. And I'm just streaming my puppet directly to him. So it's all very good, Anthony, saying you carry on talking, but he controls everything. So other than moving my head around and talking to you, I can't do much.
It's okay, I'm just trying to get Nate logged in as we've had a bit of a time mix-up. So
all right.
I'm just sorting that out for you. So. If you want to talk about anything while I sort this out.
Yep. Well, indeed. Right, there's a few people following and watching the show live with us already. We've got Subculture Tours. We've got Kasla, who we are looking forward to getting on the show one day and talking to him about his own Twitch channel. And we're also someone called Meep Meep. If anybody's got any questions that they'd like to ask us in regard to character animator, character design, animation, feel free to ask at the moment while Anthony is sorting out the technical issues. And hopefully, Mr. Nate Olson will be joining us any second now by the looks of it. I think Anthony's just tagging him in.
Yeah, hello. Hello, Nate.
Have you been working on?
Yeah, I think it's on.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Great.
Hello.
Sorry about that. You know, I think there's a number of things going on, but hopefully got it worked out.
No, it's fine. I think it might have been my fault. Did I say it was 5 o'clock, the time difference?
Yeah, but I think, you know, it's how it is. daylight savings time, all that stuff gets messed up. So let's get right into it.
Oh, sorry about that. Yes, okay, well, we'll get straight into it. I've already introduced you to everybody watching, explained that you are the Director of Marketing, Licensing and Publicity at Frederator Networks. And our first question is really, since you joined the network in 2012, what does your job of marketing publicity, does that entail?
So my day-to-day is making sure that Frederator's brands are positioned and promoted to all the right audiences, right? And that part of that is also making sure that we're making the money that we're supposed to off of our efforts. So that's where the licensing role comes into place. So licensing is licensing of the content and as well as making licensed merchandise based off of the intellectual property a Frederator has. Intellectual property being the fancy word for shows and characters. So that's what I do. So like today, we control all the rights to the Castlevania show that's on Netflix that Frederator made, commissioned by Netflix based off of the Castlevania video game. And, you know, we're trying to, you know, we're licensing it for home video, which includes DVD and Blu-ray. And we're also licensing all the different categories of publishing and apparel and toys and plush and all that stuff. So, and then I also manage day-to-day social media and the other marketing efforts, all the things you think of getting the word out there. And part of that is going back and forth with what shows we should have and how they should be framed and, you know, lots of stories. So that's what I do for Frederator.
Well, obviously Frederator is a massive network, so must keep you busy.
So Frederator has several different parts, right? You know, like we have Channel Frederator Network, which is our multi-channel network on YouTube, which includes our own channels. Like we have Channel Frederator, which is a YouTube channel with 1.5 million subscribers, where we mostly do fact-based listicles. We have Cartoon Hangover, where we've debuted a lot of original cartoons, including Bravest Warriors and Shippy and Puppy Cat. But we also do anime-based listicles, like 107 facts about popular anime shows. We also have a video game channel called The Leaderboard, where we discuss video games. And then we have Channel Frederator Network, which is 3,000 independent YouTube channels who we work with to do YouTube better, because YouTube could be looked at like a game. And so that's a lot of people. And some of our most prominent channels are ones like Domix and Jaden Animation, and Film Cow, which did Charlie the Unicorn and Llama with Hats. And we work with them to help, you know, just to help them find new business and new opportunities. We also operate a channel, our Cartoon Hangover channel is on a video platform called Verve. Verve is where people can watch Crunchyroll and Rooster Teeth and Funimation here in the United States, hopefully coming out to the rest of the world soon. So it's an interesting opportunity there. We do lots of different things. Frederator is part of a bigger company called WoW Unlimited Media, which is a Canadian company, publicly traded Canadian company. We have a sibling company that's a computer-generated CG animation studio out of Vancouver called Rainmaker Entertainment. Rainmaker makes all the Barbie films that are on Netflix. They also did the Ratchet and Clank movie a couple of years ago based off the Sony video game. They did Reboot, which was the first CG animated series back in the 90s, and they're rebooting Reboot right now. So I work with them on some things. So we have a lot of stuff going on.
Well, as you mentioned, you with the Frederator Network, you have a lot of animators coming to you and working with you. So what advice would you give to new animators who are starting up their YouTube channels, but they're starting with zero subscribers? What advice would you, what are the do's and don'ts of starting a brand new channel?
That's a really interesting question, right? So YouTube rewards a certain kind of content, right? Meaning that YouTube is looking, it has goals. Its stated object is to give people what they want to watch. And they measure what people watch and they try to give them more of it, but they don't create the content themselves. They are looking in their vast library of uploaded videos, some that are there illegally and some that are there because the creator signed the agreement with YouTube. And so they're trying to and YouTube serves that up, right, in recommendations or in search results, or, you know, just in autoplay follow-on views. And also highlights them in the trending tab, and there's other what they call discovery features. So for you, you have to figure out if you want to be successful on YouTube, you have to play the YouTube game. And the biggest part of the YouTube game is being big off of YouTube. You know, and so how do you get big off of YouTube? Well, at the heart of it, you have to have a really interesting idea. And I think what I see with, we've worked with hundreds, now thousands of individual creators over the years. Many people who get into animation don't have a big idea. What they do is they like animation. They like the process of making it, and they like participating in it. Actually, a lot of people go to animation school, think they like want to make animation, but in reality, they just like it. It's one of my biggest pet peeves currently is that we have, particularly in the United States, lots of people going to art school, taking out student loans that they can't bankrupt out of. And so there's no incentive for these art schools, which are at their heart for profit, to kick them out. And so they let them go through all 4 years. And those people aren't animators. They don't like to animate every day. They like to watch cartoons, and watching a cartoon is almost the exact opposite of making a cartoon. Actually, what I love about it is,
like you say, we should explain. There's a bit of a time lag between when you're talking and I'm talking and I'm talking. There's like a 2 second time lag, and sometimes that can give the impression that we're, because I'll say something when there's a gap, but by the time my voice gets to you, you might have already started talking again. So it sounds like we're interrupting. So
I will just
give you a heads up on that. Yeah. But I was just agreeing with you. Obviously, the thing about animation is that, you know, when you're watching it on the TV, it's one of people's favorite pastimes, just lounging out, watching TV, enjoying where the story takes you. Where animation and animating is so time heavy, you know, like you literally, I know for myself from animating, it can be quite lonely as well, because you just spend hours and hours and hours in front of a computer, or, you know, in the olden days, in front of a drawing desk. So I can totally understand what you mean about people going to university and thinking, actually, this ain't super, you know, it's not all fun, it's not all games, you know, it is hard work.
It is hard work, and it also takes a certain amount of genius to do something that's new and different enough that people want to notice it. And so this is what you have to come to, is you can be on a team and be an animator and work for someone else who has that vision. And a lot of animators end up being commissioned by well-meaning but ultimately stupid people who want them to do animated projects that won't do anything. They won't move the dial culturally. And so you have to think, as an animator, what do you have to contribute to this conversation, the larger conversation in the world? And on YouTube, a lot of animators have found a niche by making what essentially are fan films, right? They're able to traffic in someone else's show or idea or intellectual property, like Minecraft. For many, many years, Minecraft was a great way for animators to build an audience and a fan base, because they could label it Minecraft, they could put a Minecraft looking thing in a thumbnail, and if anybody clicked on it and then they had a good time watching in the first few seconds, then YouTube would serve that video up to other people. And there was a lot of search traffic for Minecraft related stuff because it was big generally outside of YouTube. Another one would be Frozen, right? Or actually, we see a couple of channels in the Channel Frederator Network do really well with Sonic the Hedgehog fan films. Problem with that is that it's not your intellectual property. So ultimately you don't control it. And so there's any number of things that can go wrong with that. It means that you can't make money other ways. Like, you're not going to ever sell those shows that you worked really hard on outside of the YouTube ecosystem, because they only work because of the Fair Harbor Digital Millennial Copyright Act safe, you know, thing that YouTube has created. And so that's tricky. And you can't, and you might even get sued, right? But that's one of the things that I recommend, actually, is that I think that a lot of animators should spend some time on their Tumblr making fan art for shows that are like the shows of where they have original characters. And it's a process of experimentation. Frederator is a big experimenter. I mean, at the heart of Frederator is an incubating cartoon ideas. Frederator's made 250 short films since it's been in existence. 17 of them have gone to TV series. 2 of them have been hits. That's less than 1 in 100 for hits. And that's Frederator not coming up with the ideas themselves. That's Frederator soliciting tens of thousands of pitches and screening them for the ones that we fell in love with to make into cartoons, right? So you have to really think about what is that you're trying to express. Simple ideas, clearly expressed in funny, unexpected ways, and put a cat in it.
So would you recommend is it better to, if you've got one idea, stick with that idea, or just try and do as many ideas as possible?
This is a big debate, right? But I like to think about it like this. Are you familiar with Calvin and Hobbes, the comic strip from the 80s and 90s?
Yeah, is that the one with the kid and is it like a cat or a little tiger? Is that the one?
Yeah, and it's tiger. Yes. It was a very big hit in the United States. And the guy who created that was named Bill Watterson. And he's a very smart guy, beautiful work. And he always knew he wanted to draw comics. Comics were a big thing when he was growing up. Syndicated comics in every newspaper in the United States and around, in many newspapers around the world. You know, there were Hagar the Horrible and the Peanuts and lots of big cartoons, comics that really made people think. And so he wanted to do that. And he experimented with a lot of different ideas. And it used to be that there was only a couple of companies that controlled all of those comic strips that were in newspapers. And he was pitching to an editor at one of them. And she was looking at the concept, and she noticed some minor characters in the strip. And she said, all of this other stuff I'm not interested in. But those two characters, that's interesting. And so he went with those two characters, and that was Calvin and Hobbes, a boy and his cat, or his imaginary cat. It's very debatable. And so there was a little bit of a tricky thing there. So what I would say is that ideas are hard to come up with. And if you have something that you love enough that you want to spend all of your time with those characters, that's a very first good indicator that you should move forward on it. Then if you put it out there and people like it, that's great. But if people don't like it, then you should probably move on, unless you have a concrete idea on how you would change it to make it more likable to fans. Because that's the other thing that you have to remember, is that if you want to pay your rent, you are making a product for a marketplace. Now, if you're an artist and you don't care what anybody thinks, more power to you. Make it all you can. You know, beg, borrow, and steal. Exploit your friends and family and your neighbors, and just make your content. And maybe it will find its audience now or in the future, but you have left a legacy of that content. And that is a very reasonable way of handling this this desire to express yourself. But the moment you want to pay your rent, then you're really finding people who want to buy your stuff, and they have to buy it in certain ways. So that's the question you have to ask yourself, is are you providing the product that the marketplace wants in the way they want it, when they want it? And that's one of the things that we do at the Channel Frederator Network, is we help people do their YouTube videos better so they work better in that platform. But if you want to take it to television, there's a marketplace. There's only a few buyers in the world who buy cartoons. There's only maybe a couple of dozen people on the whole planet out of 7 billion who buy a cartoon. And so you have to get, and they know what they're looking for. And one they're looking for is to be surprised. And they don't want to see the same things over and over again. So you have to make sure that you are creating something that people want. And that can be tricky. And that's where the rubber meets the road. Now, you can be an animator and work for other people who have that idea. And that's a perfectly legitimate thing. And actually, many animators want to be taken care of. They want some security in that equation. And so they should go and find where people are paying for animation and animation work and go work for those people. But if you really want to make your own show, and YouTube is a place for those kind of creators, you need to be thinking about what it is that people want. And so for you, you should experiment. And I think that it's about playing with your original characters and putting things out there and seeing what people respond to. On YouTube, they have a really amazing graph called the audience retention graph. And basically, YouTube can tell you where people are clicking away. So it starts off at 100% because 100% of the people have clicked on it. Almost all videos drop very quickly to about 75%. And if it's an awesome video, it will go from to in the first few seconds it will go from 100 to 75 and then it will plateau off at about 60-65% all the way until people think it's the end and that and then it drops off more, right? Crappy videos go from 100%, they drop all the way down to 10 or 20% and then they just go away. Somewhere in the middle is the average of most people in terms of what they're watching. If you see a spike, that's super interesting. That means that people are rewatching that moment. The most rewatched moment of all of our Bravest Warrior shows on YouTube is a cleavage shot of our character Beth, who is dressed like Slave Leia. It's the most rewatched moment. So that's something to remember.
Cleavage. When the horse.
Well, the paralyzed horse is great, and people really rewatch Beth's cleavage. I know because the audience retention graph gives me. So if you're going to ask me, what should I do? Should I do a whole show about Beth in Slave Leia costume showing off her cleavage? I would say probably not, because that gets tiresome. But in reality, I would want to have something like that at certain intervals in all the other content that I do, right? We also know that people like imposter bear jokes. So there's a lot of different things and ways, and we don't look just at audience retention graph. We're particularly interested in fan art. Fan art is an indication that people really love your characters, that they want to spend more time in that world. And that's, we like fan art, we like cosplay, and we like tattoos. So when we create stuff and we put it out there, we look to see not only if it gets shared, which is the first biggest indicator that people love something, because they're willing to identify with it and push it out into the world. And if they don't share it, particularly your friends who with whom you share the same tastes in content, if they don't share your stuff that you think they should like, then that tells you that you're not doing it right. Now, it's possible that you haven't found your audience, and that's very reasonable. Sometimes it's hard to get to the people who are going to like your stuff. But sometimes you don't know who that is, right? It's going to take a little while to find that out. But that's the thing, is that you're looking for those indicators. And maybe there's one idea that worked better than other, or a format, or a storyline, right? Like, I think about Homestuck often. I love Homestuck as a model for how people in the modern era can get their content out in the world. Are you guys familiar with Homestuck and MS Paint Adventures?
No, I've not heard of Homestuck. Have you?
No, I've not heard of that either.
It's a 10,000-page webcomic. Yeah, 10,000-page webcomic created by a guy named Andrew Hussey, who, if I understand correctly, had an idea for a very long soap opera kind of thing, but he wanted to get a piece of content up every day, lightly animated, did it in Flash, and he just uploaded it 1 to 3 little panels every day. And sometimes he did more, and sometimes he did a little less. Sometimes he did fully colored things. And about 1,000 comics in, he started to get his stride. And his fans were reacting to certain elements of his storyline. And so he started doing that. And his fans started to become brand advocates. And at its peak, it was doing 2 million unique hits a day on its website. He was selling tens of thousands of t-shirts. He raised $2.5 million for a video game that he just on Kickstarter that they just finished a couple weeks ago. I mean, it's really successful, and it came from him in a place saying, what can I do every day? And that's what I love about Adobe Character Animator, is that all of a sudden you can come up with something every single day. If you can write it and act it, you can figure out how to animate the puppet, and you guys can do that for, you can build the puppet for them. You can create character. That content on a daily thing. And YouTube loves daily. YouTube loves session starts and watch time. And that's another problem that we had with animation, is that our animation costs tens of thousands of dollars a minute, and we can only get so much every month. Whereas YouTube really loves videos that are longer than 11 minutes if people watch all the way through. That's something that someone like PewDiePie discovered himself. And so bringing people to YouTube and then starting people on a long session of watching, YouTube loves those videos. And so that's where you have an opportunity to get your stuff out there. And if you create characters that people want to tattoo on their hearts, they might buy some t-shirts too.
Yeah, I mean, that's also what we love about Character Animator, is that because you can make stuff so quick, it can be topical, you can start doing stuff that's in the news, and it kind of opens you up bit more, what people are interested in. Yeah, exactly.
Yep. Topicality is really big. We have we work with a set of channels called Tomo News out of Taiwan, and their whole thing is that they do 3D representations of current news things that are in the news. A lot of them are sexual things, but also they do like plane crashes and car crashes and those things, and they illustrate them and they get them up all the time. And they have a whole tool set and, you know, set of puppets and things that they're able to put into play really quickly. And it's not, you know, super high production value animation, but it's minimum viable animation, and YouTube serves hundreds of millions of views a month of that, right? So there's that possibility with Adobe Character Creator, and to deal with the topicality, right? So viral content is topical, it's funny, and it's sexy. Sexy is not necessarily sexual content, but it's got some energy to it. Those are the rules of viral content from collegehumor.com. We think about that all the time. And so for animators out there, you want to come up with something that are, you know, it's some combination of funny and topical and original, meaning it's new and people haven't seen it before, but it has to be a little bit familiar, but not in a surprising, unexpected way. And you want to get enough content out there as you know, to keep people interested, because you're competing for their attention with every other activity they can engage in. So it's a tricky thing, but there are ways through it.
Is it worth getting the content, like a lot of content made, before pitching the idea or showing the idea to anyone?
I don't know. I mean, if you're going to go it alone, I wouldn't think so. I think you need feedback pretty quickly, right? You might need to do a lot of essentially like pre-work to get it to the state where it's going to be acceptable to out there, because some people, I mean, a lot of people can't handle black and white drawings, right? Mm. A lot of people can't handle sketchy things. Their, you know, tastes are, we become habituated to certain things. So you have to kind of get it to a certain place, and they want a certain level of sophistication in terms of story and stuff. But there's a certain moment where they'll forgive a lot of other things if you're delivering something that's that they want to watch. And so that's your opportunity.
Well, the great thing about character animator, because it's actually getting really advanced now, and okay, we're just floating heads here at the moment, and a lot of people who see character animator are seeing people using it on Twitch, which is great, but they're seeing virtual avatars. But you can actually build a very complicated character, almost like a 3D character, where you can have it front on, but it can turn all the way around, jump. You can create a full rigged, full body character that can move and do anything you want. It's just how much hours you put into it. So you could actually create a very high end cartoon animation using character animator. And once that character, okay, you might have to put in a couple of weeks work to make something really complicated and to a studio level. But once it's built, then you can start churning out animations either live or, you know, within hours or within days, instead of weeks and months for like a TV thing.
Nah, so there's, you're preaching to the choir on this.
Really,
yeah. I'm so excited for this. Well, you know, when I saw the demo, we had Adobe came in a couple of months ago and showed us what I was. I immediately saw that the puppets that they were showing us were very too rudimentary, right? But the opportunity was immense. With the right insight, you could create something so compelling, and you could create a lot of content with it. I'm very excited for animators, and I would say, don't let what you see limit what your imagination can solve and fill in, because there's so many things that I think, even with the rigging, like they don't have to be the limbs. Right, that rigging can be for any kind of effect that you want to have. You know, so there's a lot of interesting things there. Sorry if it's too loud in the background.
No, it's okay.
Well, I mean, that's
you can literally.
Well, I mean, that's what we've loved about character anime. We've kind of taken it and ran with it, and any opportunity we get to add something a bit new or find another way of using one of their tools within it to do something different, like. That's what we try and do all the time. I mean, even now we're looking into trying to get a voice changer on there, and there's all the new physics engine. I'm sure there's something that we can do with that. So, like, yeah, I just wish I had some more time so we could come up with some more ideas of things to do.
I know, I'm with you. In fact, Yeah, there's no limit. And Frederator's being a little slow to adopt it, particularly on our YouTube operations. But I'm hopeful that we can figure our way through to making something really, really fascinating. And someone's going to do it. Someone's just going to blow it out of the water. And I'm excited for that content.
Yeah. It's still brand new. There's still a lot of people that don't really know about it. So at the moment, it's still a lot of people who are still, you know, completely wowed. Just seeing animations in real time. So I reckon it'll take a year or two, and especially with animation students, once more people know about it, you'll start seeing, you know, it'll be like a snowball effect. You'll see plenty start coming onto YouTube. Right, so earlier I asked you how can people build their channels, but obviously, as you mentioned yourself, Frederator is there to, you know, they've built a platform for people to join your network and you can help them. So what can Frederator do for creators who have animations and they want to get it out to a wider audience? How can they join you? And when they do, what can they expect to happen when they join your network?
Well, you can go to channelfederatornetwork.com and there's a whole sign-up sheet there. We provide you a set of resources. There's a bunch of tools, including access to sound libraries and stuff that we provide in return for a percentage of your YouTube earnings, and that can be zero at the beginning, right? Then we do a series of seminars and in-service training to talk about the different techniques. And the biggest ones is thinking about your titling and your thumbnail graphics, and then your descriptions, including your metadata, and that's all important in transmitting to YouTube how to think about what your content is, so it will start experimenting with showing it to other people, right? There's also thinking about how quickly you get into your line, right? YouTube is not a place where people have much patience. They're making decisions within milliseconds, really, about how much time they want to spend with your content. And so you need to be delivering right away. It's not like a movie theater where you're going to sit down and people aren't going to run out the door if you're not giving something interesting to them within 3 or 4 minutes. You need to deliver right away. So there's a whole sensibility that we help educate with. Then there are some promotional opportunities. There's also working on collaborations and talking about the fact that you should collaborate. Many animators are finding opportunities to do animation for bigger channels, and you should get paid for some of that work. But knowing that if they give you a shout out, if a big channel like Markiplier or Jacksepticeye or PewDiePie uses you in something and you've got some interesting stuff on your channel for people to go and watch when they see that you're mentioned in the Jacksepticeye video, that collaboration is worth real money, right? And so you have to balance out the time and energy. You shouldn't be exploited. There's a lot of smaller channels that do collaborations that end up being exploitative, right? So that it doesn't really help anybody. And so you have to weigh all those things out. I think the biggest one is making sure that what I like to advocate, and this isn't perfect, is that if you have a really good idea for original characters and you have a sense of what other shows the fans of your characters would and should like, you should create one piece of fan-like artwork that maybe you don't monetize on YouTube, right? You don't turn the ads on. But you should do this on Tumblr as well. One piece of fan art to 3 or 4 pieces of original content until you have a fan base. And then you turn off that fan art and you let it go forever, right? Or you acknowledge that you don't own the rights and that you're grateful for everything. You know, like you're not trying to be what we call an intellectual property infringer, right? But if you decide that you're gonna double down and be an infringer, know that that usually ends poorly for people, right? Particularly if you're making fun of that property or using it to make fun of other people or do other things that are questionable. So it's a hard balance, but I think that one of the things is that people are just ravenous for interesting content. And if you can hit the mark on being interesting, you have an opportunity to be as a bigger brand as has ever been, right? There's nothing holding you back now. It used to be that you needed to move to Burbank, California and pitch and work for the exact right people to have any chance of your content being seen. That's not the case. YouTube will discover it. Now, YouTube likes certain things. And there are other places, too, like VidMe. You can start, like, There's a lot of people who go to Newgrounds still to do their new content and to build an audience. And then they move that audience onto YouTube where they can, you know, do other things and build a bigger audience. And so there, you might want to think about what those other places where you should put your stuff. And it could be that it's just an Instagram at first and that you build your audience there. And using hashtags and other things. Another big thing to teach people is to do calls to action, asking anybody who comes to your video to subscribe to your channel, to like and favorite and share it, to turn on notifications, to follow you on Twitter or Facebook or Snapchat and Instagram. You have to ask, otherwise they're not going to do it. And you can ask them in funny, interesting ways, and that's going to make it even better. But if you don't do it, they won't do it. Not at the rate that they should, not at a rate that's sustainable. So that's what a lot of the things that we do. And then there are other opportunities. We're developing cartoons, original cartoons for our Cartoon Hangover Select channel on Verve, and we go out to the pool of network of the people in our network and offer them the opportunity to pitch. We develop cartoons for lots of different places. I have a colleague who's speaking really loudly over here. Let's see, that's our lawyer. You might hear some really interesting things. He's negotiating some great deals. So anyway, those are some of those things that you guys should, that everyone should be thinking about is how to audience. But at the core of it, you need to be telling an interesting story that has characters that people want to spend time with. Those characters have to seem real, and that's what animation means, right? Bringing things to life. And there's lots of ways of delighting people with animation, and you should look at using every one of those ways.
Well, another area that a lot of creators think they can go to build an audience is Kickstarter. Obviously, you managed the extremely successful Kickstarter campaign for the Bee and Puppycat series, which raised over 800,000 and became the most funded animation project, most funded web series project, and fourth most funded film video project on Kickstarter. However, I don't think many people realise that it's not just a case of... I think some people think Kickstarter is full of people that just want to invest in projects and that they only have to stick their campaign on and all the money's going to come rolling in. But it's not as simple as that, is it?
You know, there was a time early on, not at the very beginning, but shortly after the beginning of Kickstarter and crowdfunding, where it was novel and interesting enough. And there was a group of people who had a lot of fun just backing projects, right? Bee and Puppycat got probably 12% of our backers on the project came from what we think were native Kickstarter backers. But that's not the case anymore, right? It's the novelty has worn off, and there isn't those roving packs of investors looking for new things to invest in. And so the number one piece of advice that Kickstarter gives or IndieMobile and that we give is that you have to have access to a social media network before you begin, right? Because you're only going to get a certain percentage of those social media, of those people that you have access to back your project anyways. When we launched Bee and Puppycat, we had 750,000 subscribers on YouTube. Natasha Legger herself had 160,000 Tumblr followers, right? Or she had a lot of Tumblr followers. She had a big social media thing, and we only got 18,000 backers after all of that. Because remember, backers have to have credit cards, and that means that they're older than 18. So your project has to appeal to people who are older than 18. Many animators want to live in an infantilization of, like kids' content, and they live in that kind of dream world. But kids don't have any way to back anything. So if you're making a cartoon that's for kids, you're not likely to find backers. Access to that social media network can be Reddit. It could be some other thing. And actually, we had some really great friends of Frederator who had a really successful Kickstarter. I'm a pretty successful Kickstarter, and they just went viral on Reddit. It was just the nature of the concept was so interesting that people got behind it. That's the other thing, is that you kind of have to have $1 million idea to raise $1 million, right? So do you have $1 million idea? Awesome.
Okay. Well, so let's just say you do have $1 million idea. You've developed the character. It's doing great. He's smashed it on Kickstarter. It's got loads of people following him on YouTube. Oh. Is the next stage taking that character, considering licensing it? And if you do want to license the character, how do you go about doing it?
Well, the truth is if you're successful on YouTube or Twitch, meaning that your channel starts to do millions of views a month, and say tens of millions of views a month, people will come looking for you. There are tools out there. I look at VidStatsX, some people look at Social Blade, to find new properties that are growing. And there are, it's a whole host of people who will come knocking on your door wanting to do business with you. And some of the things that they offer are to license your characters for merchandise first, but also for content, right? And you might be invited to pitch. Frederator exists as a company to help people who are new, who have unproven track records, walk into the door of these big commissioning networks like Nickelodeon, Cartoon Network, Netflix, or whatever, to pitch their ideas, and so that those companies feel comfortable, you know, investing millions of dollars into that property. So there, that is a possibility for you. But I think that in reality, you can have a really successful career doing most of this stuff yourself. You know, it is hard for animators to create successful merchandise. I know it seems like they should be overlapping skills, but they're not. I have a lot of animators who give me really terrible t-shirt designs based off of the characters. Many animators are just wholly in love with their logo, and very few people want logos on their t-shirts. And animation is expressed in movement, not in static images. And so, it's better off working with a trusted, experienced partner who can create merchandise based off of your characters. And there are companies, like, I won't tell you, I can't tell you who it was. I was at San Diego Comic-Con, and I overheard a conversation between a licensee. This is a company that licenses the rights to make products based off of a show, and the representatives of a video game, an indie video game, a brand new indie video game that had been blowing up on Tumblr and getting some exposure on YouTube. And this licensee offered $1 million advance, a check for $1 million independent video game for the rights to make products based off that video game. And that video game had been developed by two guys who put it on Steam, and some people had discovered it and did fan art and some video and let's plays on YouTube, right? And that was within 9 months of it going up on Steam. So that's unusual, right? There's probably a half a dozen properties like that a year, but it can happen. And so if you nowadays it's easier to be discovered, because there are charts and there are people that are looking. Now, it might not be the very first people that you want to talk with, who you don't want to necessarily do deals with those people. You're looking for ones that are a little bit more sophisticated. But the other part of it is true as well, which is some of the people who come from the old days, they don't understand the new rules, because the rules that govern licensing and for TV shows don't apply anymore. And they used to get paid a lot more money. And they don't necessarily want these old guys who got paid a lot of money to be representing your shows. But I have recommendations. Like, as soon as you think, you know, if your video hits 3 million views, let's talk. Because some are right there. That shows that people are really into your character. Or into something about your show, and maybe there's something to do. You can pitch. You know, there, Cartoon Network, Nickelodeon, Disney, Netflix, Amazon, they're still looking for shows. They're looking for YouTube is commissioning content, right? For YouTube Red. So there are places that want your content. And there are companies that want to make stuff based off your shows.
And if people want to pitch to you at Frederator or the Frederator Network, where did I find, what's the process? Do they go on your website? Do they have to contact someone specific? How did I get in touch with you?
So if you want to pitch a cartoon, your best bet is to send an email to hey@frederator.com. And we also have pages for some of the programs that we're running. We don't currently have an active page. We're rebuilding some of our websites. But you can go to cartoonhangover.com. I mean, I can just look it up. I just search Go Cartoons. which is a program that we did for Sony Pictures Animation, cartoonhangover.com/go-cartoons. And that walks through the process that we want you to take when you're pitching a cartoon to us. Oh, and also my colleague, pitch@frederator.com. So you can email pitch@frederator.com. You can, and that will talk you through the process. Now we're looking for a specific thing, right? We're particularly interested in 11-minute short films, and we don't green light anything less than a beat board or script that covers that 11-minute short film. And what we don't like are pilots. Most pilots in television are 70% exposition, telling us about the characters and about the backstory and about the location. We don't want that. We want something that is a three-act short film. Characters want something, they go after it, and they succeed, and character is revealed through those actions, rather than someone saying, well, you know, Bob, remember when we blah, 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 and then goes on for 3 minutes telling you all the backstory, right? We don't want that. We're not interested in that. In fact, my experience has been is that we're often taking the second story in the idea, and really when you're pitching, you should be ready, you would know what the next episode is and kind of the direction it would go. Right. Many companies want a pitch Bible, which means it's like all the characters and descriptions of them and some backgrounds and maybe treatments for, you know, 26 episodes or 13 episodes. We know we can get there if we like that first, what we call a beat board, which is every line of dialogue and rudimentary images for the shots, or a full script for that 11-minute short film. We'll look at 7-minute short films too. But you have to do that minimum amount of work. That's what Frederator's learned over the years. You can't come in and be like, I have this premise, here's the 2-line pitch, and here's some character designs. Sure, pay me $1 million. It doesn't work like that.
Can I come in with an animatic, or do you want to see a full-fledged 7-minute production?
We don't even need to see an animatic. Animatics are awesome. I highly recommend animatics. In fact, it's one of my personal... Another personal pet peeve I have is I really hate when people say to me, oh, I've got this idea for a feature film. Wouldn't it be so awesome? And if you're an animator saying that to me, it's like, well, why can't I see a 2-hour long full length feature animatic from you? Right? Like, you want me to give you money, but you won't take the time to work out every beat in the 2 hours, you're going to get paid for that, right? It's like, no, dude, no, like, do the work. So sit down. It's too easy to make that stuff.
They've got no excuse now with character animator. Build your character and knock it out.
No excuse. Yeah, in fact, by the way, another thing is if you can't act out your character, right, in a way that you find acceptable or can't communicate your ideas, you're going to be a poor director. Now, a lot of creators aren't great directors, and they recognize that, and Frederator will help hire a good voice director to get a performance out of the artist. But you have to ask yourself some serious questions. Your not ability to communicate your desire or your vision, that probably goes to the level of your storytelling skills, in my opinion. Now, I don't want to get in the way of you coming and pitching a cartoon, because there's a lot of this stuff that evolves, right? But it's something that you should be working on, right? And some of the very best directors can act out every character, or at least they have a take on it.
Which animations, first of all, which animations are you personally enjoying at the moment, either at Frederator or just online and on TV as a whole?
I subscribe to Rick Morty on Amazon. I bought the whole season in advance, and it's one of the highlights of my week when I get a notification saying that a video is available. I think that this season of Rick and Morty has some of the most brilliant animated moments I've ever seen anywhere. The Rick standoff at the complex of Ricks was so awesome. Can't even describe it. So I'm really into that, and I've been getting back into Venture Brothers. I'm trying to get caught up. I'm a big Venture Brothers fan, and I really like that. I'm holding on to binge watching the end of Naruto Shippuden. I read all the manga, but I my wife and I are just trying to find some time to work our way through. I'm still in the the massive one of the end battles. I think I probably have about 60 episodes to go, but I'm excited for that.
What do you think of animations that, for example, like BoJack Horseman? And yes, I know all the characters are animals, but they do try to keep it quite grounded. So could you see, you get shows like King of the Hill, BoJack, F is for Family, and they keep it quite grounded, opposed to programs like Rick and Morty, which is and Adventure Time, where it's fantasy, science fiction, anything goes. Again, you personally, which one do you enjoy? Do you like seeing the full, taking advantage of the full animation of being able to do anything, or them sort of soul searching?
The animated sitcoms are fine. I don't particularly like spending my time with them personally, right? So I don't watch a lot of Family Guy. And I'm actually just about to do BoJack Horseman. I have only watched an episode or two, but I was waiting till it could fit in my wife's schedule. So I'm excited to watch BoJack Horseman. I think, though, that for me, what's magic about animation, see, I grew up, I consider myself lucky, because when I was 4 years old and my mom gave me control of the television, I was able to watch what they called Star Blazers here in the United States, is called Battleship Yamato over in Japan. And it was the second round of imported anime into the United States in the late 70s. Yeah, yeah. And I watched that and another thing called Ninja Team Gatchaman, which we knew as Battle of the Planets. And they were awesome. They were completely different from anything else on television at the time, other than the live action stuff that I loved. Fast forward a few years later, I was able to watch Robotech. Robotech is three different animes woven into one storyline when they translate it into English to be brought into syndicated television in the United States. And what I love about that is that this animation can do things that you can't have in reality. And in many ways, they work better than special effects, because we would reject the special effects, I think, partly from that whole thing that we usually call the uncanny valley, right? We're able to keep it at a distance. I really love when animation does things that are wildly not conforming to nature.
It sounds like you know all the tricks.
I haven't watched any anime for a while,
but the last series I watched was Attack on Titan. Have you seen that?
Yes.
I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah. No, Attack on Titan is really great. And it's one of the last one, like recent animes where they spent a lot of money. I watch One Punch Man. I've watched it now four times. I think if you haven't watched One Punch Man, you should totally watch it. Some people don't like it because they love Dragon Ball Z too much. If anything you watch between the ages of 9 and 13, you have a completely distorted view of how good it is. I miss Dragon Ball, and when I tried to watch it, and it doesn't work for me. But my colleagues that are big Dragon Ball fans, they watched it when they were about 12, 13 years old, 8, 9. They love it so much. And One Punch Man makes fun of Dragon Ball Z, right? It's skewering that whole thing, but I think it's so funny and it's really good. It has something else going on, and I love the process of how it came to be. It was started out as a web comic that was kind of crappily drawn, and but it captured the imagination of a big manga anime artist, and he came on to do a higher production value version that was conformed more to the action adventure genre and then it became an anime. After it built this audience. I love that jump from webcomic to cartoon. That's what I want to do. I'm myself working on projects where, how can I bring it to life and build an audience and vet ideas and experiment. And I think those are the steps.
What cartoon series have you got coming from Frederator?
We're really excited. We have 52 11-minute episodes of Bravest Warriors coming that will start hitting in the United States on our Verve channel, on Cartoon Hero on Verve. We also, I can't talk too much about it, but I think there's hope for Bee and Puppy Cat for more episodes, and I'm excited about that. And we're right in the middle of production for Castlevania Season 2 coming to Netflix. And it's twice as much content as we put up in Castlevania Season 1. And it's going to be awesome. Super excited about Castlevania. We also have this show Double Fine from Double Fine Video Game called Costume Quest, which is coming to Amazon. And I have high hopes for that show. And then I mentioned that we have these 12 short films from Sony that we did as a partner with partnership with Sony Pictures Animation that are coming to Cartoon Hangover in a couple of months. And some of those are really good. And then we have these short films. We have three mini-series that are coming to our Cartoon Hangover channel on Verve. One of them is from Film Cow, the company that did Charlie the Unicorn. And it's so funny. It's called Shadowstone Park. And it's about a cat and his henchman, who is a stork. And it's I'm so excited for it. And then another show called Slug Riot from a guy we worked with on a short film called On Your Electoral Morals, Michael Rosenthal, and he's so funny. And then we have one from a former intern of Frederator called Not Hero that also looks really great. So we have a lot of stuff coming out. We've been gestating things for a couple of years, and now all that stuff is coming. And we're super excited about all that stuff.
And any of the animations that you push to higher levels, have they come through your YouTube network, or is it people pitching those ideas to you?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, we love Charlie the Unicorn, we love Llamas with Hats. We've been working with Jason Steele. He's been a member of the Channel Frederator Network from almost the very beginning for 4 years. And we've always wanted to work directly with him. And we had this opportunity and this budget, and he gave us a pitch. He just finished the crowdfunding for his fifth and final Charlie the Unicorn video, and what he had of this pitch that he always wanted to do. Actually, Jason told me once that he had 75 ideas on his laptop, each had its own folder, and he was just banging through them. And if you look, for many years, he's delivered a new cartoon almost every 2 weeks. He's a prolific creator. So we're really excited. And we have, you know, other creators that we're working closely with trying to get cartoons. But it's almost like people who are successful on YouTube at playing the YouTube game don't have scripted narrative shows in their back pocket. Like it's a completely different way of thinking. YouTube tends to reward jokes and pratfalls and, you know, kind of little stunts rather than the skill set that goes with telling a story about characters. You know, and getting them through in this compelling way.
Yeah, so. YouTube's, as you say, is short, snappy, you know, low attention, where a TV show is a much more long gestating.
I've kind of found that with our kids, like the younger generation, if you try and show them older cartoons or older films, they seem to get bored. Quite early on, they need to be. They feel like they have to be entertained very instantly within a show.
They want to see the crash bang wallop immediately.
All the cartoons
we used to watch when we were kids.
Well, the thing is that when you can't really trust your taste when you were a kid, right? Because when compared to everything else, those cartoons were better. But in an ultimate test, they're probably pretty boring. I'm sorry to tell you that. But that's the case. In reality, cartoons have gotten better, and so their tastes have changed and evolved, and they are much more punchy, right? They're going for a certain kind of level. That being said, like I was just watching some Looney Tunes with my daughter, and because we have a new service here in the United States called Boomerang from Cartoon Network that has all the old Looney Tunes shows on it, and they're pretty brilliant. And even though she might have kind of resisted, she was still sucked in, right? Now, they don't do everything that new cartoon, right? But they still do a lot of really good stuff. And I think that the animation can stand the test of time. Good animation. But, you know, a lot of times what we had to watch, you know, in the 80s, 90s, 2000s, really wasn't that great when compared to other things. And I'm excited to see where we go with it, you know. I'm also excited to hear different voices, you know. Like, that's one of the things. There used to be a lot of gatekeepers, and they were looking for specific kinds of shows. mostly for boys 9 to 11 that had a specific play pattern, meaning there was toys that could be made where they could make a lot of money. Think Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. But I think now that, you know, Bee and Puppy Cat's a good example of a show that wouldn't have existed pretty much at any other time. Not even as an anime in Japan, because it does things slightly different, has a different point of view. Really appeals to people who are in that time of life where they have responsibilities and they're trying to figure out their way through them. And that's mostly when you're 18 to 34 years old. And YouTube tells us that's the bulk of our audience on for Bee and Puppy Cat. And it's a hybrid of aesthetic styles, you know, Japanese and some American. And Natasha Legger, the creator of Bee and Puppy Cat, worked on Adventure Time, where they were just groundbreaking in a number of different ways. And so it really represents an interesting amalgam of all these different kinds of forces. And I'm excited to see what comes next, because these shows now inspire the next generation. And that's one of the things that, as a creator, if you're thinking, I know how I would do this better, oh my gosh, yes, please go and do it more awesomely, right? I believe, I want to be blown away. I want the perfect cartoon, the cartoon that I don't want to spend any time doing anything else. I just want to relish in it all the time. Right. So let's just get there.
Well, Ant, have you got anything to say? Sorry, did you say something then?
No.
Sorry. Right, Nate, thank you very much for joining us tonight. I know you're really busy. Obviously, you got one of the biggest cartoon networks going on there, and I can see in the office behind you, you got a lot going on, so we won't keep you. We'll just say thank you very much for joining us tonight. You gave us loads of great advice. And we look forward to seeing more from Frederator. Like you said, I mean, Adventure Time. One second. My mind is completely blank. Bravest Warriors. I love Bravest Warriors. So is season 3 on YouTube yet?
It isn't. In fact, it's season 3 is a little bit of a conundrum. It's being distributed by our partners Nelvana out of Canada. And they are trying to do the exact right thing to help support the rollout of these 52 new episodes that are coming. And these strategic deals take a long time to hammer out. And so it's gotten caught up in this kind of the traditional way of distributing cartoons. And we're working closely with them, and hopefully it will be sorted so that people can see them on YouTube very easily and sometime really soon. But we've been saying that for like 9 months, right? So what can I say? Yeah. You know, it's there. So we'll figure that out. And I apologize to everybody. I wish that it wasn't that the way. I mean, the reality is that these shows are expensive. They take dozens of people, you know, months and months of work to get done. And that means that we can't do them on a whim. And we have to be good stewards. And the goal is not just to get it done so we can put it out there. The goal is to get it done, put it out there, and make enough money that we can make more. Right? Because this has to be ultimately a self-sustaining business. So it's rough. But, you know, we have to wait like another year for a year and a half for Game of Thrones. You know, so it's just keep on moving.
And so where is season 3 available at the moment? Where can people actually watch it?
The whole season is available with ads, and if you want to subscribe and pay $2.99 a month, you don't have to watch any ads on our Cartoon Hangover Select channel on Verve, vrv.co. So you can go to vrv.co/, and that's only available in the United States currently.
Yeah, I was about to ask that. Is that available outside of America?
You know, it's not that hard to get a VPN. So
yeah, I'll find it. Don't worry. Well, Nate, thank you very much for joining us tonight and answering our questions. And sorry for the mix-up earlier, but it was, you know.
Yeah, I'm glad that you could join us.
Glad you could make it on.
Well, I really appreciate it. I'm super excited for you guys. I when I saw that demo for the Adobe Character Creator, and then we had this conversation about what you guys do, I think that there's so much opportunity for people who are creative and who can perform or who have performers around them to create really interesting things quickly and in the way that people want it, right? And that's how YouTube is calibrated. And so I'm super, super excited to see what people do with this tool set. And the people at Adobe who created are serious scientists, right? They are really trying to solve this and solve some of the problems that have plagued animation production since the beginning of time, right? So I'm really, really excited. So let's, you know, keep it up. And I appreciate you giving me the chance to talk.
Yeah, well, you should tune in, not next week, but the week after on the 10th. We're talking to, what's his name, man? I can never pronounce his surname. Dan Ramsey?
I can't remember now, sorry. Was it Ramirez? Okay, let's just say. I think it's Dan Ramirez. I think, yeah.
Yeah, there's a fella called Dan, a dope character animator. We're talking to him on the 10th, and we're specifically talking about the future of character animator, because there's loads of new things that they're incorporating. There's loads of new things that they want to incorporate. And
I think seriously, he's the animation. An engineer?
So that'll be a great conversation.
Yeah, I'm excited.
One thing we do need to sort out is this lag. We're talking.
List of things to sort out.
Yeah, it's on our list of things to do.
But another point to make out as well, though, is with character animator, you don't have to actually do the animation. That's the good thing. It kind of opens it up to someone who's got a good idea, and then they can use a puppet that's already been pre-made, and then just start putting a quick show together, which I think is really cool. Because then you don't have to get yourself bogged down in learning how to animate, because it's, you know, a lot of, like you say, a lot of work involved.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm not saying that character animator is going to do away with traditional animation. It's definitely a very good tool in the box. I do think in the future, the way that the software is going, that you could do a full animation just in character animator. So if you're someone out there that enjoys cartoons, you can make simple cartoons. I mean, Dave Warner showed an example a couple of months ago where his son drew a picture and they just cut it out, they scanned it in, and they made a cartoon. So yes, you can make very complicated cartoons, but you can also make very simple cartoons. And
yeah, which is a good way of getting kids
interested. If you've got a good idea,
interested.
You don't need the most complicated looking animation. You can have a simple animation. Look at South Park. South Park, very basic looking animation, but it's got fantastic writing and fantastic jokes. So everything is possible. And this software is just opening it up to so many more creators who perhaps in the past, animation was, you know, like you said before, it might have been, you know, out of reach for them, where now they can, you know, give it a second go.
Yeah, no, I think that it's another tool in self-expression, and that we're going to be able to see things that we've never seen before that are delightful.
Well, I know we were keeping you, so we'll let you go. And once again, thank you very much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much. We'll see you guys. Bye.
See you later.
Bye. What I'll do is...
Has
Nate left the building?
Nate has left the building.
He's gone.
Yeah, well, again, that was really interesting.
Thank you once again. Yeah, no, it was great. And Frederator is fantastic. It is one of the best platforms for animations out there. So for anyone, I'm sure most animators have heard of Frederator. But if you have not, go and check out their site. It really is a great platform for new creators to get their animations out into a big audience that is, you know, thirsty, hungry for new animations. Seriously, so got sort out this time, like.
That's okay. So then, because we've kind of been a back to front show at the moment. What's next up? Is it obviously we've done school time.
We're going to do Showtime.
Showtime.
Okay. What have you got to show us this week, Anthony? Have we got music? Nope.
Music was not. Oh, we're gonna try that again. We have always ended up having to do it twice. All right. Try that.
So what are you showing us, Ant?
I'm showing a new puppet that we have.
Wasn't the curtain supposed to stay down?
Nope. We're just going to showcase a new puppet that we have available on our store. As it's Halloween coming up, we thought we'd make a Halloween pumpkin. So he's got a few features, like
angry face. You could do something really interesting with that. You could stick it in your window, put the get a TV, stick it in the window, turn the lights off, make it look like it's a pumpkin sitting on the windowsill, and then when the trick-or-treaters come up to the door, I don't know, try and scare them.
Yeah, well, that's it. Yeah, stick a screen within the window, and like you say, yeah, as people walk past, talk to the kids. It's just, I've seen a few people doing that with projections and stuff. Yeah, you can do some cool stuff. But I thought, Halloween coming up, we've got to make a pumpkin.
Oh, you can do it with a projector, if you've got one.
Also, I've added some movement to this one, which I've also noticed. So if you put, there we go, if we add some, if you up the head tilt, you can actually make the pumpkin's head roll.
Yep. Yeah, you gotta tweak it. Get it working.
So yeah, that's what we've got today.
Okay, and did you have another one you wanted to show us? If anybody wants the pumpkin, we'll put a link below later on, and you can find out where
it's now available on the store. Well, it was just a bit of a fun one.
That's a sales pitch.
Yeah. But no, also like.
So what's the next character you want to show us, Ant?
That's it. We haven't got any more characters to show this week. The only thing I was going to.
I thought you were going to show us what Imogen did.
Yeah, I was going to do a quick video and show. Something my daughter made, and it just kind of shows that, you know, it's so easy. This thing is so easy for kids. Like, once it's set up for them, they can just sit there, chat away, and make their own little YouTube shows that are a little bit more interesting. Let's play this.
Hi, it's Imogen, and welcome to our channel. We're going to be playing this or that. So, we're going to get on with the first question. Be stranded on an island alone, or be stranded on an island with someone you hate. I would say be stranded on an island with someone you hate, because you won't be alone, and you'll probably be...
Okay.
What would you do, Ant? Would you be stranded on an island alone or with someone you hate?
Obviously someone you hate. You just something to do.
I don't think so.
Well, would you? I think Imogen's drunk.
Well, okay, put it this way. You're saying you want to stay on an island with somebody you hate, yeah? But how much do you hate them, and how much do they hate you? Do they hate you enough that they want to kill you?
But it gives
if
you
you're on your own, you're okay.
You can spend all your days planning on how you're going to kill that person. Simple. If you're on your own, you've got nothing to do.
Yes. I suppose if you hate them enough, you could find it entertaining to kill them. You got that. But then, you know, they might kill you back.
They're not going to kill me. I'm an evil pumpkin.
Yeah. Kill you. They'll stand on you. You're not going to put much of a fight. You've got no arms.
Yeah.
You're like that knight out of Monty Python and the Holy Grail.
I'm no longer a pumpkin.
Right, okay, well, that was showcase time. And the show is almost over, but we do have one last section, and that is cartoon news. Ant, you got the cartoon news room for us?
Cartoon news. Right there.
Okay.
Your audio disappeared for a second.
In cartoon news. Okay, you deal with the technical side, and I'm just going to go ahead and talk about cartoon news. Right, cartoon news.
What are we talking about on cartoon news?
What
are we talking about on cartoon news?
If you didn't interrupt me, I'll say what we're talking about in cartoon news. Right?
Well, if you tell me what it is, I'll get the video.
The first thing we're talking about in cartoon news tonight is Aardboil, which is a new platform for original, upbeat, animated comedy created by Aardman Animation. The channel features a mix of brand new content from well-known creators and exciting new talent, along with lesser-known gems from the Aardman back catalogue. They are always on the lookout for new creators to come on board. So if you're making a funny animation, you could be part of the Aardboil family. I'm just reading what's on the page information. Have they got a trailer?
I don't know if they have got a trailer. I'm just having a look. They've got, here we go.
Yeah, go up. Go up.
That's it.
I don't think that was a trailer.
Here we are.
Right, well, there you go then. Potato. If you're looking to be entertained, go along and find Aardboil on YouTube. Or if you've got content, you got another place that you can pull it. You got Frederator Network. Or
I wasn't sure. What is this then?
I'm not 100% sure. Where obviously Frederator is a network where you join, you know, you join this family, so to say, and you get support and whatnot. I think Aardboil, I don't know if it's a similar thing or if it's just a showcase where they find the funniest videos that people send to them and they put them on the page, which I suppose Aardman's got a big following. So if people were to get accepted and their videos were put on the page, then it's a good way of building their brand awareness. Definitely worth trying. And if you're not an animator, then obviously it's just a lot of funny videos to watch.
Mm.
Another cartoon funny channel. Hmm?
Okay.
What are your thoughts on it, Ant?
No, it sounds interesting. Like I say, it might just be another avenue, another place to pitch your cartoon ideas to by the looks of it. So, which is quite good, you know, for making short animations. Yeah, there seems to be more and more stuff becoming available. So, what was the next on the showcase?
You know when we're talking to each other, what we're going to have to do?
What?
You know, like when people used to talk on the old, what they call, CBs? And they go, like, roger, roger. They say whatever they're going to say. And
they say,
like, roger out.
No, say over.
Yeah, over, that's over. It. Yeah, so when you finish talking, say, over. Then I know you've stopped talking and I can say something without it sounding like I'm interrupting you. Over.
Over.
Okay, let's get to the next story. Right, what I want to bring people's attention to is a cartoon I came across last week called Final Space. Now, this has been on YouTube for quite a while. In fact, this cartoon has been in development for ages and is very much close to coming on the TV. Actually, the whole pilot is on YouTube. If you look up Final Space on YouTube, there's about an 8-minute cartoon of the pilot. And it's fantastic, but we're not going to show that because I don't even think we're allowed to show that. But there is a trailer, so we'll show that. Anthony, roll tape. Over.
Chuckity, chuckity.
Let's do this!
Oh, crap. We're on the wrong freaking planet.
Oh.
This is the end. I failed freaking hard. When I became a warden in the Infinity Guard, I just really wanted to pick up killer sweet babes. I never would have thought it would have led to this.
Fire! The Gary has been brought to his knees.
Don't forget, Gary. Save the universe.
Fire everything! Rip that ship from space!
Looks like we got our butt cheeks into another hot vice avocado. Peace out.
Now, pause it, Ant. The trailer looks very nice, but like I said, I've seen the actual full pilot for it, and it is really, really funny. The trailer doesn't actually get across how funny it is. But not only is it funny, it's got heart, it's got real emotion in it. And it's also one of them shows you just know it's going to have a massive backstory, a huge universe that the characters live in. And I actually think that this cartoon is going to be another one of the, you know, you've got to wait and see, but it reminds me, it gives me the same impression of when I first watched the first episode of Rick and Morty. It's got great characters, it's got good humour, it's got good sci-fi, and also interestingly, that fella right there in the middle, his name is Olin Rogers, and I don't even know if he's a comedian. I think he just posts funny videos on YouTube, but he's hilarious. And for a while now, for a couple of years, people have been taking his stories and turning them into animation. So definitely check out his channel. He's really funny. And he is the creator, not the animator, but the person behind Final Space. I really think this is going to be a series to look out for. So check it out on YouTube. Have you watched it yet, Anthony? Over.
No, I haven't. But it does look good. I see what you mean. I think it's kind of following the whole what the last two interviews have kind of said about how important the characters are.
Yeah.
And yeah, like I say, it looks quite funny. And you can that's the thing. It's straight away you can kind of tell, like, if you watch an episode of a cartoon, even you only have to see one episode, and you can kind of suss out the characters straight away. And that's what you kind of you should be looking for when you're making your own, I think. Yeah, that's definitely what I'll watch. You get to see what...
Yeah, sometimes characters do just come across as a cliche. You know, they come across as hollow. They're just blaring out any old line and they're hitting their beats. And sometimes you get a show, again, like Rick and Morty, Adventure Time, where even though the cartoons, they're like, you know, it's like the characters have soul. That's I don't know, stupid way of describing it, but you know, they feel real.
Yes.
And
yes,
like I say, check out the pilot for that, because
it's going to be a great cartoon. It's what people say. You actually care about the characters, and you know, you want to know, you root for them, you want them to do well, or you know, that's the whole thing. Like the main character in a show, you really want to do well. Otherwise, if you didn't, you wouldn't want to watch it.
Well, talking about, I should stop. You know what I've noticed watching these videos back? I go, too much.
Yeah, I've noticed that too. I do it as well. Mental note. So stop saying, and say over. Over.
Over. Yeah, over.
Okay, then.
Yeah, over. Yeah.
Are we all done for showtime?
No, we're going to do we're going to watch one last trailer, because I haven't actually watched this trailer yet, but I've seen a lot of, Wes Anderson's Isle of Dogs. That's it, yeah. I haven't watched this trailer yet, so let's put it on and let's see what we think. Because there's been a lot of good reviews about it. Well, comments on the trailer.
The Japanese archipelago, 20 years in the future. Canine saturation has reached epidemic proportions. An outbreak of dog flu rips through the city of Megasaki. Mayor Kobayashi issues emergency orders, calling for a hasty quarantine. Trash Island becomes an exile colony. The Isle of Dogs.
I don't think I can stomach any more of this garbage.
Exactly. Same here. Words out of my mouth.
A very fantastic giving Mr. Fox looks to it.
And don't you forget it, ever. You're Rex. You're king. You're duke.
You're boss.
I'm chief. We're a pack of scary, indestructible alpha dogs.
Atari Kobayashi, you heroically hijacked a junior turboprop XJ-750 and flew it to the island because of your dog.
Darn it.
I've got a crush on you.
Spots up.
We get the idea. You're looking for your lost dog Spots. Does anybody know him?
No.
I've lost all of my pride.
Spots, if he's alive, may very well be living even at this moment as a captive prisoner.
Somebody is up to something. Will you help him? The little pilot.
Why should I?
Because he's a 12-year-old boy. Dogs love those.
We'll find him. Wherever he is, if he's alive, we'll find your dog.
Ah! It's gonna be a fight!
I wish somebody spoke his language.
Wow.
To the north, a long rickety causeway over a noxious sludge marsh leading to a radioactive landfill polluted by toxic chemical garbage. That's our destination.
Over. So what are your impressions?
Yeah, that's good. You, like I say, you can definitely tell it's made by the same makers of Fantastic Mr. Fox. The whole kind of look feel to it. Which isn't a bad thing, it's good.
It looks amazing. I love the aesthetics of it, you know. I love the aesthetics of the show. God damn it, you try to stop saying Right, it looks great, but...
yeah.
Does the story look interesting to you? It's from
I don't know. It's hard to tell.
Wes Anderson is the one who did films like The Royal Tenenbaests.
Yeah, you can tell it's that type of thing. But they're good films. Really,
well, I think it's like Marmite. You either love them or you don't. Yeah. Because to me, they're a bit kooky for the sake of being kooky. And there's no bloody story. In my opinion, that's not everyone's opinion, obviously, but I don't know. What do you like them films?
Yeah, I do. It doesn't really, like I say, this trailer doesn't really give away much, I don't think.
Sometimes these sort of films don't. They're just a bunch of characters going. I don't know. I'll watch it. I'll definitely will watch it.
That's like animation style. It looks great, but story wise,
animation's brilliant. I agree. Story wise. It doesn't get me interested. Not interested in the same way as I am for... Okay, maybe I'm just not sophisticated enough. You know, I'm not one of these that wants to see the, you know, the soul-searching, artful, meaningful movie. I just want to watch a big, stupid Marvel film. I'm really looking forward to seeing 4. I'm really looking forward to seeing Star Wars. I just like big adventure stuff.
That's fair enough.
Yeah, I know for a fact that your favourite film is the Care Bear movie.
Sure, there's...
Actually, I think this is the best film ever made. Transformers, the original, 1986.
That was a great film, by far, but like...
Great film.
Nate was saying, have you ever tried to watch the Care Bear movie again? It's terrible.
I haven't tried watching the Care Bear movie again.
I remember it being great.
I think Nate mentioned this earlier about going back watching old cartoons. I tried watching He-Man. I tried to get my son, Zach, to watch He-Man and the Masters of the Universe. And after I watched it for about 2 minutes, I thought, I can't make him watch this. This is terrible. Why the hell did I like it?
Yeah, but you got to remember then, back in those days, a lot of the cartoons were made purely just to sell toys. They're just big adverts.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You say that, but... There's some great cartoons in the 90s.
Well, 1980s. Isn't like I saw a thing on Facebook today. Things like an anniversary of The Visionaries was released so many years ago.
30 years old. I remember that coming out and watching it on a Saturday morning. Yeah, The Visionaries, Jason and the Wheel Warriors. What was that other one? Kissifer. What was the one when it was a bear with a bloody centipede or caterpillar thing in a floating air balloon? What was that called?
No idea what you're talking about.
Teddy Rupskin, that was it.
I don't know.
You not remember Teddy Rupskin?
I know. I remember Rupert the Bear.
Rupert the Bear was the worst thing ever. That wasn't even a cartoon. That was just a comic book strip with a voiceover. I hated Rupert the Bear. The only good thing about Rupert the Bear was the frog song for Paul McCartney.
Should we do some comments? Let's have a look. Let's see what comments we've got today.
Yes, let's check out. Start from the beginning.
Start from the beginning. Okay. A lot of the questions have been answered, I think.
I did see the questions. It was going, and they had been answered, like from Joanna Mendes. We're rubbish at saying names, aren't we? Joanna Mendes said, "Hello, how do I pitch for a cartoon?" And that was something that we discussed in depth with Mr. Olson.
Yeah. Also, we've got Kaz's said hello. He's here. We've got Nathan Thomas. Like I say, Joanna Mendes, Memory Sports. We've got, some of them I can't pronounce.
What's Nathan Thomas talking about? It's, hey guys, anyone want to check out my progress on my show? It's on Cartridge.
Cartridge.com. We'll put a link to that. We'll check that out. And we'll
put that in the description. Is that his website or is that?
Yeah, I don't think the comments let you put a website in, so it's left the gaps in.
We'll check it out and
we'll check that out and have a look.
We'll put it on next week's show, just in case, you know.
Yeah.
Make sure it's appropriate. What other comments have we got? We've got Kaiju Kojo. Did you reply back to him, by the way, about doing a crossover?
I think so, yeah. I think I sent the...
You think so? Do you know
so? I think so. I'm sure I sent an email explaining how it all works. But, hello.
Definitely have to do that. We're looking forward to that one. We can discuss some more cartoons in depth with him. I think he's from Japan. So he might have a bit of a getting a time thing right.
Yeah, well, next time
we're sure probably about 6 o'clock in the morning at the moment.
But... We won't leave that up to you next time because I'm pretty sure it was you who sorted out the time thing, even though all you had to do is go onto Google and then put what the time is.
Oh, it's because the time keeps changing in the UK.
Does
it do that everywhere in the world?
Keiju Kojo just said yes, he has. I did send the thing, so that's good. Good to know.
Yeah, we'll have to get that organised because I'm looking. That will be a good one, a crossover. Where anything just discussing some more cartoons, Rick and Morty. That's something I really want to talk about. I really want to discuss some of the storylines on Rick and Morty. But now is not the time.
No, it's time to wrap.
There's one more episode left of Rick and Morty.
Is that?
Have you seen the most recent one, the ABC of Beth?
No, I haven't actually. Is that one out?
You know what?
No,
it's
not
seen that on Netflix.
One. Nah.
It's out in the US on Adult Swim. But yeah, I saw it. It was another good episode. It was another good standalone episode. It wasn't like the one with the, you know, with Evil Morty. And I'm hoping in next week's last episode, it's called the Rickadian. Oh, I forget the name of it now. But I'm hoping it's going to go back and deal more with the whole President Morty, because I have a feeling that they'll probably end up leaving that until season 4, which we probably won't get for another 2 years. They should make it in character animated, then it'll be done by next week.
Well, definitely
needs to. Oh, I've goosed it. Hang on. It's so I was looking at the message from Kaiju Kojo, just confirming that he is an American citizen, but he's currently living in Japan. We've got a friend in Japan, haven't we?
We do indeed.
Yep. Okay. I don't know, Shiva.
Okay.
Okay, let's end this show. We're rambling. It's time to draw a curtain. Say thank you for everybody joining us again tonight. Thank you once again for Mr. Nate Olson. From Frederator for coming on and talking to us for about an hour, giving us loads of advice and his time. I'm sure it's much appreciated by many creators out there. And yeah, that's it. Thank you very much. I think that's the end of the show. Anthony, over. Literally, over.
It's over. Okay, let's say goodbye and we will see everyone next week, next Tuesday. Do we have anyone lined up for an interview next week?
Yeah, we've got... we're talking to Gavin from Green Man Animation. He's talking about how he started up his cartoons on YouTube. I'm looking forward to that one. That'll be a really good show. it's great talking to all the big networks. They've got great information, but it's also good to talk to people
who are actually doing it and who's doing the animations doing and stuff. Okay, I'm looking forward to that.
Forward to that one. Yep.
Brilliant. Okay then. So it's time to drop the curtain.
We've got to figure out a better way to finish these shows.
Well,
let's just say goodbye.
If you stop talking, and then we say goodbye, there we go.
I said goodbye about 20 times, and I was expecting you to make the curtains drop down, but you didn't do anything.
It's because I didn't say over afterwards, so goodbye, over.
Okay. Goodbye, over. Bye.
Try that again.
Is that over?
What?
The curtain thing comes up.